Okay, so now let me start with my lecture today. I will go a little bit more into detail about the semiconductors and the charge carrier in the semiconductor. And why we need to go in detail? Because in the whole operation of a solar cell is determined by the motion of the charge carriers. Okay, so charge carriers includes electron and hole, and therefore we should be knowing how many electrons are there, how many holes are there, how the number of electron and hole is changed by the doping, how the number of electron and hole pair is changed by the light falling on your solar cell, how these carriers, how the electrons is moving in a semiconductor, and what is the implication of the motion of these carriers on the performance of the solar cell, or when a solar cell, or we all know that, you know, solar cell is a p-n junction device. So when a p-n junction device becomes a solar cell. So there are various things, and again, don't worry about the, if there are some complicated equation, do not worry about it. Just try to understand the basic concept behind all this, and the book that you have got, all these details are there in the book. So you can read more details. So just do not worry about it. Just try to understand the basic concept regarding the charge carriers and their motion and the generation, recombination, and this all determines the physics behind a solar cell. Okay, so last lecture we have learned about the electronic arrangement of atoms, formation of the bands. We have learned about the direct and indirect band gap semiconductors. So now, in this lecture, we are going to look about the charge carrier and their numbers. Okay, so we look about p-type semiconductor, n-type semiconductor, intrinsic, extrinsic, majority carriers, minority carriers, and how many numbers. The most important thing is how many numbers of carriers are there. Okay. Because eventually when the light falls, current should flow, and the flow of current is given by, flow of current is nothing but rate of flow of charge. Okay. So rate of flow of charge means we should know the number of charge carriers. So this is what we are going to discuss in this lecture. This you already know, that the many semiconductors that can be used for solar cell application, and crystalline silicon is one of the most common semiconductor. 80% or more of the photovoltaic modules produced in the world is actually manufactured in silicon. But the combination of cadmium and telluride, for example, this is referred as a 2-6 material. Zinc sulfide, okay, zinc sulfide, these are the semiconductor that is used. So 2-6 material. So there's many combinations of semiconductors also used. You can combine one semiconductor, two semiconductor, three and four, in order to get the best electrical and optical properties, so that you can make good solar cell. Okay, yesterday we discussed about the formation of the bands, right? Why the bands form? So when many atoms come together, energy levels split, because it follows the Pauli's exclusion principle, because no one energy level cannot occupy more than two electrons. So they split little bit energy, and this, when many atoms come together, trillions and trillions of atoms, the splitted energy level becomes almost continuous, and they form what is called energy bands. So if you look at the energy versus space, so remember, what is y axis of this? Y axis is space, and what is the x axis? Y axis is energy, and x axis is space. So when we look at the band gap, there is some space in energy, there is some energy levels where electron cannot occupy the position, that is called the energy gap. And you have the valence band, which is normally filled at 0 Kelvin. All the energy levels, all the houses available are filled by the electrons at 0 Kelvin. There is a conduction band where there are a lot of energy levels are available, but they are all empty. It is available, and any electron which has a higher energy can go from low energy to high energy and occupy those levels. Okay. So this is the situation of a semiconductor at 0 Kelvin. Okay. Conduction band is completely empty, and valence band is completely filled. Now when you increase your temperature, okay, more than 0 Kelvin, what will happen? Some of the electrons in the valence band will get enough energy to get excite themselves and go to the conduction band. Okay. Some of the electrons will get enough energy, go to the conduction band. In this way, what is possible now, that there is a partially empty conduction band and partially empty valence band is available, a charge transport can happen. Okay. But in the filled band, it cannot happen, and why, I will show you. So for example, if you have the conduction band, valence band, in the valence band there are many electrons, okay, there are many electrons sitting here. And I said that in the, when it is a filled, at 0 Kelvin, all energy levels are occupied, right. So, this electron, suppose it moves here, this moment is only possible if this electron moves here, right, otherwise there is no place. What does it mean? And if this electron moves here, this is possible only when this comes here. What does it mean? The net flow of charge is 0. Net flow of charge is 0 means current conduction is not possible. And in conduction band, there are no carriers. There are no carriers, so no moment is happening here. So, current conduction in due to the conduction band is 0. Current conduction due to the valence band is 0, and therefore net current is 0. Okay. So, therefore, what is the conclusion? The conclusion is that the field conduction band and completely filled valence band, okay, and completely empty conduction band cannot conduct current. Okay. So, filled band cannot conduct current, or completely empty band cannot conduct current. So, what can conduct current? Partially filled band. Okay, partially filled band. Why it is possible? The partially filled band can conduct the current. I will show you again on the sheet. Suppose again you have this scenario. Now your temperature is higher than 0 Kelvin. Okay, as a result of that, there are electrons here. But let's say this electron has excited and gone to the conduction band. And now there is a hole here. Okay, absence of electron is a hole, and you have the other condition exist. Okay, so this is the condition. What about this electron? It can move, right? It, because there are many houses available, so it can go from here to here, it can go here to here, and so on. So, this electron can move. What about this electron? Can this move? So, yes, this electron can go from here to here, and this is available house. So, no electron has to come back to the reverse direction. Okay. And therefore, now this is a net flow of electron taking place. Okay. So, partially empty or partially filled bands can conduct current. Okay, very important. And what is current? Flow of charge. Rate of flow of charge is current. Rate of flow of charge is current. So, okay. So, partially filled and partially empty bands are required. The one very good thing about the semiconductor is this control about the creating partially empty and partially filled band is with us. Okay, and this control is there, and we can actually change the number of electrons and number of holes in a semiconductor by a process called doping. So, that control is with us, and that is one of the most important control that we have in the science and technology. Without this control, without this changing the game or the changing the number of electrons and holes in semiconductor, the operation of any integrated circuit, any chip, any mobile, any solar cell is not possible. Okay. So, we have this control, we will learn more about it. Okay. So, some terminology. So, when electron goes from a valence band to conduction band, it results in a generation of an electron and generation of a hole. So, this hole is called the EHP, electron hole pair. Okay. Note this point, that silicon atom density is 5 × 10^22 atoms per centimeter cube. Okay. In a silicon, which is the commonly used semiconductor for solar cell, there are 5 × 10^22 atoms per centimeter cube, many atoms. Okay. At room temperature, because of the thermal energy of the room temperature, okay, 25 degree centigrade, some of the electron goes to the conduction band and creates electron hole pair. Normally in silicon, the room temperature, the number of electron hole pairs are about 10^10 EHP per centimeter cube. Okay. What does it mean? It means that there are 10^10 electrons and there are 10^10 holes also, okay, because it is the pair, right? It is an electron hole pair. So, at room temperature in silicon, there will be 10^10 electrons per centimeter cube, and there will be 10^10 holes per centimeter cube. Okay. So, this is the concentration of electrons in silicon at room temperature, and this concentration is referred as a Ni, intrinsic carrier concentration, and this whole concentration is referred as Pi, intrinsic whole carrier concentration. Okay. One very simple thing you can answer now very easily, that the number of this carrier at room temperature will depend on the band gap, right? Will depend on the band gap. If I have another semiconductor which has the higher band gap, okay, so I have same valence band level but very high conduction band level. Okay, so this is my conduction band edge and this is valence band edge. This was a silicon, but this is, let's say, gallium arsenide. Okay, we know that gallium arsenide has higher band gap. Your temperature is same, so but your band gap is higher now. So energy required to go for electron from a valence band to a conduction band will be higher. What will happen to the electron and hole concentration at room temperature in gallium arsenide? What will happen? It will be higher or lower, because now the more energy is required to in a gallium arsenide, more energy is required for electron to grow from valence band to conduction band. There is a less probability that at room temperature the electron will get excited, and therefore in the higher band gap material the electron and hole concentration at room temperature, or what is referred as an intrinsic carrier concentration Ni, Npi, will be lower. And if the band gap is lower, like germanium has a lower band gap as compared to silicon. In germanium, the electron and hole concentration at room temperature will be higher. Okay. One other point that you can note from here, because it is a pair, so which means Ni has to be equal to Pi. Okay, a electron is generated and then only hole is created, and therefore the electron concentration and hole concentration in intrinsic semiconductor has to be equal. So hole concentration is equal to the electron concentration. This is what I am saying there. Ni is equal to Pi, and this in silicon is about 10^10 electron hole pair per centimeter cube. This we will discuss later, the purity of silicon. Okay, now. What I am showing here is the recombination rate is equal to generation rate. So this transfer of electron because of the thermal energy, right? Electron from here has gone to the conduction band. Because of what energy? It got the thermal energy, and because of this thermal energy it is called the generation process. Okay, but electron can also come down and occupy a hole, right? So this process is called generation. And this process, reverse process, is called recombination. Okay, so when electron gets excited because of the thermal energy, it goes from valence band to conduction band. It is called generation of electron. And when electron comes back from the conduction band to the valence band by losing its energy, it called the recombination. And typically, a generation rate will be equal to recombination. Okay, we are talking about intrinsic semiconductor where we have not made any impurity. So pure silicon, intrinsic means pure silicon, no other impurities are there. Okay, it's pure silicon. That is the meaning of intrinsic, perfectly pure silicon. Okay, but what we want? We want control over the conductivity. We want control over the conductivity. We want to change the number of electrons. We want to change the number of holes so that conductivity of the material can be changed, and therefore we get the control over the performance. So as Professor Fernandes was telling you, there are diodes which are either used as a diode, it is used as MOSFET, some is used as a BJT and IGFT and what not. How the same semiconductor can give you different performance? Because there are different kind of junctions, and because there is a different carrier density, there is different electron and hole density. Therefore, the control over the number of carriers in a semiconductor is very important. And I am repeating again that we are lucky to have this control in semiconductor, and that is one of the most important thing that humankind has, is the control over the charge carriers in semiconductor, and because of that operation of every possible circuit is there. Okay, so we want to increase the number of electrons, in some cases we want to increase the number of holes, and that will bring me to the two concept in semiconductor. So we have the three. If you look at the category of semiconductor, we have Okay, so we have one category is called intrinsic semiconductor, SC. Okay, what does it mean? Highly pure, no doping, no impurities, no desired impurities. Second, we have P type semiconductor, and we have N type semiconductor. Fine. P type semiconductor will have lot of positive charges. Okay, will have holes, many holes. Okay, N type semiconductor, N represent for negative, P represent for positive. M type semiconductor will have many electrons. What is the situation in intrinsic semiconductor? Electrons is equal to hole, the number, I am talking about number here. Okay. So, neither electrons are more nor holes are more. In intrinsic semiconductor, both electron are equal to hole concentration. In p type semiconductor, there are many holes, more holes as compared to electrons. In n type semiconductor, there are more electrons as compared to hole. The important thing that we should learn here is how many is the number. Okay. The 5, 10, 1 million, 1 billion, 1000 billion, what is that number? We want to know that number, because once we know the number, we can control the conductivity, we can control the performance of the device. We want to know the number, and that is what we will try. So, first of all, how to change that number? Okay. How to make a semiconductor or a crystalline silicon or intrinsic semiconductor majority of holes? How to make the holes, how to create the holes? And for that, we have to look at this diagram. Okay. So, semiconductor is represented in two ways. One, we have looked the energy band diagram. What is energy band diagram? You represent that, okay, there are conduction band, valence band, y axis is energy and x axis is distance. Another way to represent semiconductor is it's a bonds. Okay. So, here silicon has this kind of arrangement. If you do not know the details, do not worry about it. So, this red circles are actually silicon atoms. Okay. So, each silicon atom is and I have shown the example here. So, this is typically intrinsic silicon. So, each silicon atom has, you know, remember silicon has 14 electrons. How they are distributed? 2, 8 and 4. So, in the valence there are 4 electrons. Okay. So, each silicon has a 4 electron, but in order to have a stable orbit, you need 8 electrons. So, what silicon do? Each silicon atoms partner with the neighbor. Okay. In order to make a stable, a silicon atom has 4 valence electron, but you want to make a stable material. So, therefore, each silicon atom should have 8 valence electron. How to get that valence? It makes a partner with the neighboring atom. So, okay. So, what they do? They share electron. Similarly, it makes another partner with another neighbor atom, the share electron. They share electron, and they share electron with the neighboring. Okay. In this way, now there are 8 electrons. And how these electrons are there? They are shared between the two atoms. This is called the covalent bonds that forms in silicon, covalent bonds. Do not worry about the bonds also. The important thing is that now this is a stable material, and this kind of order will continue. If it is a monocrystalline, this order will continue infinite. That is what we discussed, right? Same order continues infinite. So, this is another way to show the material. This order will continue infinitely. What is this line showing here? What is this line showing here? It is showing a electron. Okay. So, when this line is absent, what does it mean? The electron is absent. Okay. So, suppose if I show here, if I show only one line, two line here, two line here, two line here. This means that one electron here is free, it is moving. Okay. So, it is available here. So, it is not bonded with this atom, and that is what is generation of electron hole pair, right. And there is one possible electron that can come here, means there is a hole here. Possible electron that can come here, there is a hole. So, this electron is a free electron. When we want to create more holes, what we do is we take a material like aluminum. Remember, aluminum comes from the group 3. Group 3 means valence 3. Okay. I'll go back to the same slide again here. So, when we have group 4 means all these atoms, carbon, silicon, germanium has 4 valence electron. All these atoms, boron, aluminum, gallium, indium has 3 valence electron. All these atoms, zinc and cadmium has 2 valence electron. If you go to the other side, phosphorus, arsenic, antimony has 5 valence electron, okay, 5 electrons in the outer orbit, and sulfur, selenium, tellurium has 6 valence electron. So what will happen now, if I replace one silicon atom with the aluminum atom, what will happen? Because aluminum has only 3 outside electron, 3 valence electron, it has one shortage of electron to make a pair, okay, it has one shortage of electron. And shortage of electron means what? Absence of electron means what? Hole, okay. So therefore, if you put one aluminum atom in silicon, you get one hole, okay. If you put 10 aluminum atoms in silicon, you get 10 holes. If you put 1 million atoms of aluminum in silicon, you get 1 million holes, okay. So by putting aluminum atom in silicon, what you are doing? You are creating as many number of holes as the number of aluminum atom. Are we changing electron concentration? No. So therefore, impurities which are from column 3, boron, aluminum, indium, gallium, this all can become a what is called the acceptor impurities, okay. This because it is having a shortage of an electron here, so it can accept electron, and therefore it is called the acceptor impurities. So basically, when you put aluminum in silicon, you create hole, right. So now if you, and this process is called doping, okay. Putting other impurities, and these are the desired impurities, okay. Okay, aluminum is desired. Why it is desired? Because we want to control the number. Aluminum is desired, it is called desired impurity. So when you put one aluminum atom, it gives me one hole. If you put 1000 aluminum atom, it gives me 1000 holes, okay. If I put 10 to the power 15, okay, huge number, aluminum atoms per centimeter cube, it gives me 10 to the power 15 holes per centimeter cube, right. So in this way, by putting aluminum in intrinsic silicon, we are doing the doping, and this doping, because of this doping, we are creating holes, many holes, and therefore the semiconductor becomes p type semiconductor. Is this number is a large number? 10 to the 15 hole, is this a large number? Is this a large number? Then the question should be with respect to what? So the large number with respect to how many atoms of silicon are there, okay. So the atomic density of silicon, you know, I told you earlier, atomic density of silicon, how much is this? Is 10 to the power 22 atoms per centimeter cube, okay. So as for 10 to the power 22 atoms, 10 to the power 15 is a very, 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 very small number, okay. In 1 billion silicon atom, there is only one atom of aluminum. So this is not a very large number. Just to tell you that most of the silicon still remains silicon, only very small percentage of aluminum can actually create that many hole concentration. Is that clear? Okay. Now because of this aluminum, what happens is aluminum creates another energy level. Remember, every atom has its own energy level. So when you put aluminum silicon, it creates its own energy level. For aluminum, the energy level is created very close to the valence band, okay. Now because this energy level are so close, that at room temperature all the electrons actually will go and occupy this energy level, and therefore you are creating holes. So this is how you can understand that by putting aluminum, you are creating lot many holes. How many holes? 10 to the power 15 per centimeter cube aluminum atom means 10 to the power 15 holes per centimeter cube. And the rest is simple, okay. If we need to generate 10 to the power 16 holes per centimeter cube in silicon, what should be the number of aluminum atoms per million atoms of silicon? Solve that question. Let me tell you that aluminum is normally not used for the making p-type semiconductor, the boron B, okay. Boron is also coming from the third column. So boron is normally used for the making p-type semiconductor, okay. Fine. So with this analogy, what are the things you understand now? By making the atoms from the column 3 in periodic table like boron, aluminum, you can create holes. The number of holes is the same as the number of doping atoms they are putting, okay. And this energy level, because of this doping of a p type impurities like boron aluminum, is created near the valence band, right. So, this is a p type semiconductor, more number of holes. Now, similar analogy you can extend it for the n type semiconductor, where you want to create more number of electrons. Okay. So, if I ask you a question, what are the impurities you should put for the creating more number of electrons in a silicon, then answer should be that I should have extra electron to give. Okay, I should have extra electron to give. Okay, so that we are told that now we have silicon. Here, if I have some other impurity, I have another silicon, another silicon, another silicon. Okay, each silicon has this one atom, one electron, which is sharing with the neighboring silicon. Suppose I put phosphorus here. Okay, now phosphorus is a pentavalent; it has 5 electrons in the valence, so it will share one electron with this atom. It will share one electron with this atom. It will share one electron with this atom, it will share another electron with this atom, and it is left with one extra electron. Okay. So, this one extra electron will be easily available. Okay. So, now putting one phosphorus atom, you got one electron. Okay. Same analogy can continue. Okay. One phosphorus atom will give one electron, right? 1000 phosphorus atom will give 1000 electron, and 17 phosphorus atoms per centimeter cube will give you 17 electrons per centimeter cube. Same analogy as we did in the p type. Okay, n type also, now you put more pentavalent impurities like phosphorus, arsenic, and you can create more electrons. Okay, so this kind of semiconductor will, because there are more electrons, it's called n type. Okay, in the previous case this was because we are putting the aluminum, or as I told you, boron, then this becomes a p type. Now in this case it is called n type. Okay, fine, the number is clear that you can put more numbers by putting the n type impurities. Here I have given example of antimony, and I will not spend time with this slide now. Phosphorus, arsenic, antimony, because they can donate one electron, they call donor impurities. Okay, and in the n type semiconductor, majority carriers are electrons. In the p type semiconductor, majority carriers are holes. Similar to the in acceptor impurity or p type, the energy level was created close to the valence band. In this case, the donor impurities like phosphorus, arsenic will have their own energy level, and this energy levels are close to the conduction band. And because this energy difference between this donor energy level and the conduction band energy level is small, so electrons are easily donated. Okay. Now, these electrons are in a partially empty conduction band and they can conduct the current. I will not go. So, let me come to this directly, that is what I told you. In intrinsic carrier intrinsic semiconductor, the electron concentration, which is Ni, is equal to hole concentration, is about 10 to the power 10. Numbers per centimeter cube. If donor density is ND and acceptor density is Na, okay, ND is the concentration of doping atoms, right. If donor density is 10 to the power 16 atoms per centimeter cube, what is N0 or electron concentration? 10 to the power 16, okay. So, N0 is 10 to the power 16. If accepted impurities, which is boron, aluminum, is 10 to the power 16, what is the hole concentration? 10 to the power 16, that is I am telling. Okay. Doping, number of dopant is equal to the number of either electron created or hole created. In reality, things are little different, but do not worry about that. This is good enough to understand right now that if you are doping with 10 to the power 16 phosphorus atom, you create 10 to the power 16 electrons. Notice one thing here, that now the electron concentration is called N0 and the hole concentration is called P0. Here, electron concentration and hole concentration was Ni, Pi, intrinsic, I stands for intrinsic. Here, 0 stands for the equilibrium condition, means this is the condition where there is no temperature, no external force, no electric field, no bias, no magnetic field is applied. Okay, that is what 0 means, it is meaning equilibrium. Okay, so I will put here for you again summary on the whiteboard, that Ni is electron concentration, Pi is a hole concentration, and this refers to the intrinsic situation. And we also talk about N0 and P0, these are the equilibrium equilibrium concentrations. Okay, equilibrium electron and all, okay, Ni, Npi, N0 and P0. Okay, there is a very interesting relationship between N0, P0 and Ni, which is equal to Pi. We will come back to that. Now, one thing is fine, we have so many electrons and holes, okay. Okay, this is our conduction band, this is valence band edge, this is conduction band edge. Conduction band is above this, valence band is below this, and this is the energy gap. So, suppose I am making n type semiconductor, suppose I have n type semiconductor and I am doping with the phosphorus atoms such that there are 10 to 16 atoms per centimeter cube, and therefore, there are 10 to 16 electron per centimeter cube. Where this 10 to the 16 electron will be? This 10 to the 16 electron will be where? It will be in the conduction band. Okay. When you talk about holes, they are in the valence band, and when you talk about electrons, they are in the conduction band. This is the energy axis, you know, this is the space axis, fine. So, there are a lot of empty states available. So, where are these electrons? Whether they are here, whether they are here, they are here, they are, because this is a whole energy band, right? We know that this is a band, conduction band. So, electron can be here, it can be here, it can be here, it can be here, it can be anywhere. That is what is given by what is called the Fermi-Dirac distribution. Okay, just try to understand that Fermi-Dirac distribution is actually one kind of statistical model that explains the possibility of finding electron at a given location. Okay. So, let me read here, it defines Fermi-Dirac statistics defines the distribution of carriers over available energy states following the Pauli's exclusion principle. Distribution of electron over the range of allowed energy level at thermal equilibrium, remember thermal equilibrium means room temperature, is given by like, okay. So, this is probability density function, okay. F e is the probability of a finding electron at energy level E. And that probability is given by 1 over 1 plus bracket E minus E f, E is any energy level and E f is the Fermi energy level. And I will come back to that, what is Fermi region. K is the Boltzmann constant, which is given here, the values are given here, 1.38 times 10 to the minus 23 joule per Kelvin, and T is the temperature in Kelvin. Okay. So, this gives the distribution, and let me go to the whiteboard here. So, basically this function, this Fermi function F E, this Fermi function F V will tell me what is the probability that electron is here, what is the probability that electron is here, what is the probability that electron is here, here in it. This is a probability density function. Similarly, we can write a probability density function for the hole. Okay. If the probability to find an electron is F E, so the probability to find a hole, what is hole? Absence of electron. So, probability to find a hole is what? 1 minus F E. Okay. If the probability to find an electron is F E, the probability to not find an electron, which is hole, is 1 minus F E. So, this is the probability to find an electron, and probability to not find an electron is 1 minus F E. I just show you how this graph, this probability density function is plotted. First of all, note one thing, E F is the Fermi level. Okay. Now, when I put energy E equal to E F, what will happen here? When you put E equal to E F, this will become 0, E raised to power 0 is 1. So, we have 1 over 1 plus 1. So, 1 over 1 by 2. So, at Fermi level, the probability of finding an electron is 1 by 2. That is how the Fermi level is defined. It has otherwise no physical significance. It is from the statistical point of view, we say that Fermi level is energy, where Fermi level is energy level at which the probability of finding electron is half, 0.5. So, that is how you can draw the statistical, that probability of finding electron is 1 above the Fermi level, and probability of finding electron is 0 in the 0 Kelvin, but at actual higher temperature, at the room temperature, the curve is not between 1 and 0, it has a smooth transition. Okay, so this is what I told you, the probability, f is the probability to find electron that an electronic state is occupied, and 1 minus f is the probability that state is not occupied, it is empty. Okay. So, this is the, this is how we can see that in this case where the intrinsic silicon, the lot of electron, all the energy levels in valence band is actually filled, and therefore, probability is 1, probability is 1. Here lot of electron and available energy states or houses are empty, and therefore, probability is 0. Okay. So, this is my probability that electron is available or not available, but what I am interested, in finding the number of electrons. Okay. So, look here, what will happen in the n type silicon, because now we are doping and we are increasing the number of electrons in the conduction band, and therefore, now you, your probability becomes non-zero, greater than 0, right. Okay. Similarly, here probability of finding electron is 1, because all the states are filled, everything is filled. So, there is probability of finding a hole is 0, but when you make a p type semiconductor, there are holes available here. When you make a p type semiconductor, holes available here, and therefore, probability of finding an electron becomes less than 1, which means probability of finding a holes becomes more than 0. So, this is how your probability density function gives an idea about where is the electron and how many are there. What we are interested is, we are interested in finding the number of electron and in terms of the probability. Okay. So, look at this equation, interestingly it defines that. Okay. If I have certain probability of finding an electron at an energy level, and if I know how many such energy levels are there, let me repeat. If I know the probability of finding an electron at a given energy level is, let us say x, and if the number of energy level is y, then if I multiply x into y, I get the number of electrons. Okay, I get the number of electrons. Okay. So, my number of electron will go from EC, conduction band edge. Okay, this is my conduction band edge and above. Okay. So, my probability density function is this, this is the number of states, the density of state, the number of energy level, and this is my probability. And the product of the two, NE, NE is the number of energy levels available, and FE is the probability that that particular energy level is occupied. If I multiply by this two, I will get the carrier concentration. So, typically I will get this kind of arrangement. Okay. So, that lot of carriers are there in conduction band, close to the conduction band edge. Okay. Look at the conduction band edge, close to the conduction band edge. And similarly, intrinsic carrier, lot of holes are there, and number of electrons are equal to number of holes. The area of this green patch here is the number of holes. So, let me explain you this point again. So, I know the number of energy levels available to me is NE. The number of and the possibility that those energy levels are occupied is FE. And if I multiply this two, I will get the number, okay, but number of electrons, but this number is at energy level E, right. But if I draw the valence band and conduction band, this is the edge of the conduction band, this is the edge of the valence band, and there are many energy levels above this, and there are many energy levels below this. Okay. So, if I want to find out the electrons in all energy levels, I must integrate this from conduction band edge to infinity. So, that is why if I integrate this conduction band edge to infinity, I get the number of electrons, right. Now, this is for finding an electron. Suppose here I am interested in finding holes. Okay. Hole is the absence of electron. Okay. So, if the probability that electron is occupied at energy level is Fe, the probability that electron is absent is 1 minus Fe. And if I multiply with the number of energy levels available, it is Ne. And again, if I integrate this from where to where, now I have to go to lower energy level. If I integrate it from Ev to minus infinity, this side, then I get the number of holes. That is what we are talking about. Okay. So, this is the mathematical way of representing, and this is the graphical way of representing. This is how you can represent graphically. So, this was the case what happens for the intrinsic. This is the case what happens for the N0. Now, N0, you see that there are more number of electrons and less number of holes. More number of electrons, less number of holes. And your Fermi level is closer to the conduction band. In the p-type silicon, your Fermi level is closer to the valence band, and you have more number of holes as compared to electron. And this is what we have learned already, that if you put more aluminum atoms or boron atoms in your silicon, you get more number of holes. If you put more phosphorus atoms, you get more number of electrons. Okay, so this is simple to understand that how we are creating p-type semiconductor, how we are creating n-type semiconductor, and more importantly, we can find out the number of electrons in n-type and we can find out the number of holes in p-type. This is further elaboration of that mathematical thing that we have present here, we have stated here. So, do not worry about it, this is extra information those who are interested, otherwise if you do not understand, no problem. Okay. Eventually, I will come back to the direct expression. Because of the shortage of time, we do not have time to go into detail, but I will come directly that N0, that is electron concentration, can be given here. NC is the effective density of states. Similarly, P0 is given by this expression, where NV is effective density of states in a valence band, NC is the effective density of states in conduction band. The most important point that I want to make here that if EC becomes closer to EF or EF becomes closer to EC, your N0 increases. And let me show you by the drawing. Okay. If I draw the energy band diagram, how does it look like? EC, EV, and in case of intrinsic level, it is middle. Okay. So this is intrinsic case. If I draw the energy band diagram for the n type, this is for the n type. Okay. My Fermi level is closer to the conduction band. What I am saying is the distance between these tells me how many electrons are there. Okay, so if Fermi level is closer, if Fermi level is here, then it is more electron concentration, more doping. Okay, same thing. If it is conduction band and this is my valence band, and I have p type semiconductor, my Fermi level is close to the valence band. Okay, my Fermi level is close to the valence band. And if the Fermi level is closer to the band, then I have more and more doping. This is expressed by this equation. If my EC is close to EF, so that the negative coefficient is 0, so that my N0 is higher. If my EF is close to EV, valence band, then my P0 is higher. Okay. So, in this way, I can actually find out the electron concentration and hole concentration. One simple way to find out electron concentration or hole concentration is what? Doping level, right? If your doping level is 10 to 15 atoms per centimeter, then your electron is 10 to 15. If your boron doping is 10 to 16, then your hole density is 10 to 16. Okay? But these are what I am representing here is a mathematical way of doing that. Mathematical way of representing the electron and hole concentration in your semiconductor. Fine. So now your in case of the Fermi level is here, in case of intrinsic, which is equal to EI. Okay, in case of intrinsic semiconductor, your Fermi level is middle of the band gap between the two. So then, if I replace EF equal to EI in the previous expression, which is this expression, here I am replacing EF, which is the Fermi level in the doped semiconductor, which is equal to EI in the intrinsic. So I get this expression PI. And similarly, there should be Ni and Pi. Okay, what is Ni? I told you earlier, Ni is the P0, right? I told you, right? Ni and Pi is the intrinsic carrier concentration of electron and hole. N0 and P0 is the equilibrium carrier concentration of electrons and holes. Okay. So that is what. Now, in this equation, this drawing, this slide, you have both your intrinsic carrier concentration of Ni and Pi and extrinsic or the doped carrier concentration N0 and P0 at equilibrium. Okay. So, now you have both of this and this is represented in the 4 energy level EC conduction band H, EI intrinsic level, EV valence band H and EF Fermi level. So, this is represented. So, basically the summary of all the discussion we have done in the last is this 4 numbers Ni, Pi, N0, P0. Do it as a homework, but if I multiply N0 with P0, you get N with Ni and Pi, the expression is equal. Okay. What does it mean? N0 P0 is equal to Ni into Pi. Okay. Very important and we will use a lot and you should know this. and I'll just put some numbers here again. So and this is your homework, prove that which is equal to pi square, right? Prove that n0 p0 is equal to ni square, which is equal to pi, because ni is equal to pi. Wonderful. What does it tell me? It tells me many things. Okay, this expression we will use again and again and again and again. So make sure that you know this, you know all the symbols here very carefully. N0 represent equilibrium carrier concentration for electron, p0 represent equilibrium carrier concentration for hole. Equilibrium means no external bias, no temperature, no magnetic field, nothing as it is. Ni is intrinsic carrier concentration for electron and pi is intrinsic carrier concentration for hole. Okay, very nice. This number is fixed for a given material. Ni is equal to pi and it is fixed for room temperature. And for silicon, how much is this? I told you this number already. For silicon, how much is this? 10 to the power 10, right, per centimeter cube. 10 to the power 10 electrons per centimeter cube or 10 to the power 10 holes per centimeter cube. And I told you higher the band gap, smaller is the Ni and pi. Lower is the band gap, higher is the number. Okay, what does it tell you? Because this number is fixed, Ni square is fixed. So if you are making a semiconductor n type, okay, if you are making a semiconductor n type, you can change the number of electrons. You can make the 10 to the power 15 electrons, you can make 10 to the power 16 electrons, you can make 10 to the power 17, or you can make 10 to the power 18, any number. Okay, you by doing different doping, okay, these are the various doping level. If you do the different doping, you can actually create more, and these are all N0. These are all N0 number. What does it mean? If your right hand side is fixed and if you are increasing your N0, what will happen to P0 for N type semiconductor? What will happen to P0? It must decrease. It must decrease, isn't it? So if this is 10 to the power 15, what should be your P0? 10 to the power 5. Right, so that the product of N0 P0 equals Ni square. Ni square is 10 to the power 20, because this is 10 to the power 10. Ni square is 10 to the power 20, right? This is 10 to the power 20 for silicon. Actually, little more than 10 to the power 20, but a good approximation is this. Okay, this is actually 10 to the power 20. Okay. So now, if your doping level is 10 to the power 15, you are creating 10 to the power 15 electron, your whole concentration will become 10 to the power 5. Okay? If your doping level is 10 to the power 16, your whole concentration will be 10 to the power 4. If your doping level is 10 to the power 17, your electron concentration is 10 to the power 17, your whole concentration is 10 to the power 3. If your electron concentration is 10 to the power 18, your whole concentration is 10 to the power 2. Okay? Interesting. So at the end, what we are saying, N0 P0 is equal to Ni square or Pi square, whatever it is. Why it happens? So basically, when you are making a semiconductor n type, you are increasing electron concentration, but you are decreasing hole concentration, right? That is what it means. If you are increasing electron, you are increasing and hole, I am talking about concentration, you are decreasing. And this is, I am talking about all about n type semiconductor. Same thing will be true for the p type semiconductor. Why it happens? More important. Why it happens, right? So you have, let me draw the scenario that you have n type, I am talking about. Because of doping, you have created many holes. Okay, because of doping, you have created many electrons. But you have some holes also, and there are many electrons here also. So what is happening? Because now you are doping, you are increasing the electron, and this electrons are very far large in number, let us say 10 to the power 16, and these holes are small in number, and intrinsic case 10 to the power 10. What happens? As soon as the electron is created and population is more, this electron will come down and recombine. This electron will also come down and recombine. So more number of electrons will reduce the hole population. Okay, more number of electrons will reduce the hole population, and therefore in n-type semiconductor, if you are having 10 to the power 16 electrons, you have only 10 to the power 4 holes, such that what? N0 P0 equal to Ni square. Same thing will apply to p-type, by the way, and let me end with this. Same thing will apply to p-type semiconductor, that N0 P0 is Ni square or Pi square. in p-type semiconductor, which number will be higher? P0 will be higher. Hole concentration will be 10^14, 15, 16, 17, and therefore your electron concentration will be 10^4, 5, 3, 2, whatever is the case. But your p-type semiconductor, this must satisfy. Okay. Fine. Is it clear? I think enough. So this is the main crux of this lecture is this. I'll give some idea about this later in the next lecture, or let me finish this here. Let me this. So intrinsic carrier concentration so I'm ready to take the questions now. Let me summarize this. What we have discussed in this lecture, that it is important that we alter the concentration of electrons and holes in semiconductors so that we can change the behavior of semiconductor so that we can get the desired functioning. So we can use semiconductor for making a diode, we can use semiconductor for making a solar cell or IGBT or VJT, one thing. Second thing, we have discussed how to change the number of electrons hole pair by doping, by creating more impurities. So by putting impurities like boron, we can make it a p type or hole majority. By putting phosphorus, we can make it n type or electron majority. If I put 10^15 boron atoms per centimeter cube, I create 10^15 holes per centimeter cube, and corresponding number of electrons reduces. If I put 10^16 electron phosphorus atoms per centimeter cube, I create 10^16 electrons per centimeter cube. Okay, and product of N0 and P0, electron and hole, is always equal to Ni square, which is equal to equilibrium carrier concentration. Ni is equal to 10^10 per centimeter cube for silicon, and this number can be different for different semiconductors. So that is the summary. Let me take a questions now. NIT Calicut.
Defining a space. We are only considering energy levels as far as the distribution of electrons is considered. Is the definition of space going to be significant in this? My question is how are we defining this space?
How do I define?
Because for a particular space coordinate, if you define in suppose 3-dimension, suppose if we take that 3-dimensional space, the location of electrons or holes at a particular space coordinate, that diagram gives
in the space. For example, if I take a semiconductor which is a 10 centimeter thick, right? So one coordinate is a space, right? So I can start from the surface of semiconductor, then I can go deeper in the semiconductor. So that is my space coordinate. So as compared to this space coordinate, how do I define my energy levels, right? So this energy levels of a carriers in a semiconductor is a function of the interaction between the atoms, right? Many atoms come together, and when they come together, their energy level of a different atoms interact with each other, and therefore they create energy bands. Okay, now this electron at any given space, okay, at a surface or in the middle of the semiconductor or the 10 centimeter deep in the semiconductor, can have various energy level, and that will depend on its excitation. It will depend on whether it is getting thermal energy or not. It depends on whether it is in excited state in a conduction band or it is in the ground level or the valence band. So that energy level within the thickness of the semiconductor of electron can be varying at a different location. Okay. So it is very much possible that when electron travels from one side of the semiconductor in physical space to the other side, it energy levels, it goes through the various energy levels depending on its interaction with the light, with the thermal energy, and with the bias. PhD College, Coimbatore.
What is the optimum carrier concentration for good silicon device?
Okay.
Is it p-type or n-type?
Okay, good question. So optimum carrier concentration is defined by what the functioning we need. Okay, for example, for solar cell, it is not good to have very low concentration, because once you have very low concentration, your conductivity will be lower, right? Or if you have very high concentration, your conductivity will be higher, and we'll see that expression. So how much should be the concentration determines by the function of the device that we want. And let me tell you here that for solar cell, the optimum concentration is about 10^16 boron atoms per centimeter cube. Typically, solar cell is fabricated in a p-type semiconductor, and in that p-type semiconductor, the optimum concentration is about 10 to the power 16 boron atoms per centimeter cube.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, NIT Agartala.
The definition of permeable is that the probability of finding electron.
Right.
Okay. Now, what you have seen in the diagram, energy diagram, that permeable is always in between the valence band and conduction band. That means in the forbidden region.
Right.
How it is possible to get the electron in the forbidden region?
Yeah, I got it. So it's a good question that because there are no energy levels in the band gap or in the, how it is possible that you talk about any energy level in the band gap? Okay, so let me tell you again that Fermi level is just a concept. Okay, it only helps us to understand how the probability of electron to occupy a given state depends and changes. So therefore, definitely the energy levels are only in the conduction band and the valence band. There are no energy levels in the forbidden gap, but this is just for the understanding. We defined a Fermi level and it comes like that. The probability of finding energy level at is about half or 0.5 at Fermi level, and this is just a concept. In reality, there is no Fermi level. Okay, it is just a concept for us to understand the distribution of electron at various energy levels. Okay, NIT Kurukshetra.
My question is that you have discussed about silicon, but when we make composite semiconductors like zinc oxide or zinc selenium, then how do we decide the top carrier concentration? How do we decide what are the
when you have the compound semiconductor like cadmium telluride or zinc sulfide or any other, how do you define the carrier concentration, right? Whether the same same equation of probability of electron density and the hole concentration, and whether the same N0 P0 equal to Ni square will be true or not. So yes, it will be true. Even in a compound semiconductor, you can define intrinsic and extrinsic carrier. So even compound semiconductor also needs to be doped. Okay, so even in compound semiconductor, you do doping, and when you do the doping, this you can define the electron concentration, and the product of the two N0 P0 will always be equal to Ni square only under equilibrium condition. Okay, Jalgaon.
Sir, my question is that while we were talking about mounting of the solar cell. So my question is that whether with the temperature, the efficiency, it increases or decreases with temperature. As the temperature increases, its efficiency increases or decreases?
The efficiency of a solar cell with temperature decreases. Okay, so the solar cell doesn't like the temperature, and when we progress and we study more this course, you will understand why it happens so. Okay, for the time being, yes, efficiency of the solar cell decreases with increase in temperature.
Sir, if it is so, if the with the temperature the efficiency is decreasing, then why do we mount it by considering the noon time?
Well, because the radiation intensity is so high at the noon time as compared to the morning time, that the net effect will be positive. So the net gain will be there in the afternoon because your intensity, the light falling itself is very high. So definitely you are going to lose little bit because of the temperature, but definitely you get more energy output at the afternoon. Okay, I'll take one last question from Kakinada.
What are the limitations for doping level, sir? How will be the Fermi level changes?
Okay, so what is the limitation for the doping level? Doping level can be as little as 10 to the power 10, 10 to the power 11, 10 to the power 12, or it can be close to the silicon atomic density. What is the silicon atomic density? 10 to the power 22 atoms per centimeter cube. Okay, now you cannot actually dope any atom by 10 to the power 22, right? It will not be silicon anymore. So the limit to the doping level is about 10 to the power 19 or maximum 10 to the power 20. There is what something called solid solubility of the material, and no other material can go beyond that limit. So the higher side limit is about 10 to the power 19, 10 to the power 20.
Is there any relation between Fermi level and doping level, sir?
Yes, whatever the expression that I have shown you is actually gives you the relationship between the Fermi level and the doping level. Okay, the N0 is equal to ND, right? Let me tell you that. I'll come back to that. So or let me go to the slides, right? This N0 in this slide, look at the slide, N0 is equal to what? N0 is equal to ND, that is the donor concentration, doping concentration, and this is a Fermi level. So there is a relationship between the doping level and the, look at here also, N0 is related to the Fermi level. P0, that is the acceptor concentration or the doping level, is related to the Fermi level. So yes, these are related. Okay, last question I answer from the SGS ITS, how efficiency depends on the material structure. Okay, as we discussed that material structure can be, you know, very bad, like amorphous, or you can have monocrystalline, or you can have polycrystalline. So when you have very good material structure like monocrystalline, then the defects in the material are low, and because the defects are low, the recombination is low, and recombination low means your efficiency is higher, right? But when you go for material like amorphous, where the structure is very bad, in fact there is no structure in amorphous silicon, and therefore there is a lot of recombination that takes place in amorphous silicon, there because of that the efficiency is higher. Okay, so as you go from very high quality structure to a low quality structure, the efficiency of the solar cell goes from high efficiency to the low efficiency. Okay, so let me stop here.